In the name of Allah, the entirely merciful, the especially merciful. O you who have believed, when the adhan is called for the prayer on the day of Jumu'ah, then proceed to the remembrance of Allah and leave trade. That is better for you, if you only knew.
إِنَّ الْحَمْدَ لِلَّهِ نَحْمَدُهُ وَنَسْتَعِينُهُ وَنَسْتَغْفِرُهُ وَنَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ شُرُورِ أَنْفُسِنَا وَمِنْ سَيِّئَاتِ أَعْمَالِنَا مَنْ يَهْدِهِ اللَّهُ فَلَا مُضِلَّ لَهُ وَمَنْ يُضْلِلْهُ فَلَا هَادِيَ لَهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ سَيِّدَنَا وَحَبِيبَنَا مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَرْسَلَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا مَنْ امْتَثَلَ سُنَّتَهُ فَازَ وَمَنْ أَبَى فَإِنَّمَا يَأْبَى أَنْ يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ أما بعد قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الجليل بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم إن زلزلة الساعة شيء عظيم يوم ترونها تذهل كل مرضعة عما أرضعت وتضع كل ذات حمل حملها وترى الناس سكارى وما هم بسكارى ولكن عذاب الله شديد ويقول الله تبارك وتعالى فاذكروني أذكركم واشكروا لي ولا تكفرون ويقول الله تعالى الذين آمنوا وتطمئن قلوبهم بذكر الله ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب ويقول الله تبارك وتعالى واذكر اسم ربك وتبتل إليه تبتيلا ويقول تعالى فسبحان الله حين تمسون وحين تصبحون ويقول الله عز وجل يا أيها الذين آمنوا اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا فالحمد لله الحمد لله We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we praise Allah azza wa jal. No matter how much a person was to attempt to devote himself to the praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he would have never fulfilled Allah's right to praise. And no matter how much a person was to dedicate himself to declaring the greatness of Allah azza wa jal, he wouldn't have come even to a fraction of a percentage point of declaring the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like Allah azza wa jal mentioned in Surah Al-Kahf, that if all of the trees, Allah azza wa jal were to make them pens, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were to convert all of the oceans into ink, seven oceans into ink, and Allah was to bring another seven oceans with them, Allah says, مَا نَفِذَتْ كَلِمَاتُ اللَّهِ مَا نَفِذَتْ كَلِمَاتُ اللَّهِ The words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's praise would never end. The descriptions of Allah's greatness would never end. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ That they have, people cannot fathom, they cannot understand the greatness and the power of Allah as it should be understood. وَالْأَرْضُ جَمِيعًا قَبْضَتُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have the entire earth in His grasp on the Day of Judgment. وَالسَّمَاوَاتُ مَطْوِيَّاتٌ بِيَمِينِهِ And the heavens, they will be rolled in the hand of Allah as is befitting of the greatness and the jalal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَ عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ Glory be to Allah azza wa jal above all that anyone can imagine, above all that whoever ascribes a partner to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how is it that Allah azza wa jal will roll the heavens in His hand? In what manner? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَوْمَ نَطْوِي السَّمَاءَ كَطَيِّ السِّجِلِّ لِلْكُتُبِ That on that day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will roll the heavens in the same way that papers are folded for a book. Like you have the heavens, Allah will take the heavens and fold them and end it. Huh? Game over. كَطَيِّ السِّجِلِّ لِلْكُتُبِ كَمَا بَدَأْنَا أَوَّلَ خَلْقٍ نُعِيدُهُ. In the same way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created all of creation, إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا أَنْ يَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. Allah, if He desires, if He intends to do something, He simply wills it into existence. He says to it, be and it is. So in the same way that Allah created all of the heavens and the earth and what is between them and mankind and animals and insects with be, in the same way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will recreate us in that condition which we died in. So if you died, huh? If you died with a certain injury, you will be raised with that injury. If you died mulabbiya, making talbiya, saying labbaik Allahumma labbaik, labbaik la sharika laka labbaik. If somebody was going to the house of Allah for Hajj or Umrah, and he dies in a condition of talbiya, on the day of Qiyamah, he will be raised making talbiya. If somebody dies in sujood, Allah will raise him in sujood. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will recreate us and recreate our bodies, and we will be gathered in front of Allah naked, barefoot, and uncircumcised. And Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, O Rasulullah, men and women next to each other, looking at each other. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained to her that, O Aisha, the situation will be so grave, they won't worry who is standing next to them. They won't notice what is happening around them. No one will know that they barely will notice they are naked, let alone somebody else next to them is naked. Huh? That is the day that young children, young boys, young children, their hair will turn white. يَوْمَ يَجْعَلُ الْوِلْدَانَ شِيبًا. That day will make hairs white from the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear respected brothers, it comes in hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَثَلُ الَّذِي يَذْكُرُ رَبَّهُ وَالَّذِي لَا يَذْكُرُ رَبَّهُ كَمَثَلِ الْحَيِّ وَالْمَيِّتِ. That the example of the person who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the person who does not remember Allah azza wa jal is the example of the person who is alive and who is dead. Everyone in this life seeks happiness. Everyone in this life seeks success. But the deception of this life is that happiness and success is in anything material. Wallahi, it has nothing to do with anything material. Happiness is a condition of the heart, not a condition of your bank balance, and not a condition of your wallet, and not a condition of the car that you drive. Happiness is something that occurs internally within a person's heart, within a person's chest. At that point, where there in your heart, you feel happiness. Huh? It's not with the feel of money in your hands that produces happiness. That's a deception. Huh? Happiness is occurring in a person's heart. So what are the means towards happiness? What are the means for a person to have a life of fulfillment? Huh? A life of meaning. And not simply a life. Eating and drinking and sleeping. Like everyone is eating and drinking and sleeping. Allah has not created us. أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْنَا لَا تُرْجَعُونَ. Allah is saying, do you think we have created you without purpose and that we are not returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We will be returned to Allah azza wa jal, and we will be asked about every moment. And that person who lives his life according to the purpose for which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created him for will live a life of happiness. And this is by the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً إِيش؟ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً وَعْد مِنَ الرَّحْمَنِ. That person who lives his life in the pursuit of good deeds with belief in Allah. His heart is filled with iman and his life is filled with good deeds. That for that person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises them, regardless of whether they are male or female, that they will have a good life. They will have a happy life. They will have a life of fulfillment. They will have a life of satisfaction. They will have tranquility. They will have mental peace. They will have from the treasures of Allah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept, like it mentions in hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَإِنَّ الْخَيْرَ بِحَذَافِرِهِ فِي الْجَنَّةِ That all khayr, with all its aspects, originates from Jannah. It all comes from Jannah. There is no way that you can do a amal that's origin will lead you to Jahannam and that it will bring you any khayr. There is no khayr, there is no good in the disobedience of Allah. No matter how it appears to you, you think there is khayr for you in this life with the disobedience of Allah and that there will be shar, there will be evil for you after you die. As a Muslim, this is the deception of shaitan. There is no khayr for you now, and there is no khayr for you later in the disobedience of Allah Azza wa Jal. Except that shaitan, فَزَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَعْمَالَهُمْ That the shaitan, his work is beautification. He takes that which in its origin, in its asl, is rotten, which in its asl is putrid, and which in its asl, in its origin, is evil. And he beautifies it for the human being. So it appears as if that is what is khair. Just like he did to our father Adam alayhi salam. That he beautified for him that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had forbidden for him. And was there any khair for Adam alayhi salam in that? There was no khair for him. There was only difficulty. And this was only, that was in his life. Allah brought him to dunya. So in the same way, my dear respected brothers and sisters, all the khair is in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All peace in life and all tranquility in life is in the obedience of Allah azza wa jal. And the most prevalent way, the best way for a person to cure themselves of all kinds of psychological stress and difficulties in life and problems in life is to hold fast to the dhikr of Allah azza wa jal. How much do I remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How much do I hold fast to the remembrance of Allah? Like it mentions in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that the example of the one who remembers Allah and the one who does not remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the example of the one who is alive and the one who is dead. So when you are in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are in a state of life, you are alive. And when you are ghafil, when you are heedless of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is if your heart has died. Now this is the difference between life and death. Is whether you are conscious of Allah or you are heedless of Allah. You are not thinking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that when a person is conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is protected from waswasati shaytan. He will be protected from the whispering of shaytan. And that when a person is ghafil, is heedless of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is exposed to the whispering of shaitan. Shaitan, he will spend his time struggling against the whispering of shaitan. Shaitan will tell him, go this way. He will say, I know I shouldn't, but it's still pulling him in that direction. He is still feeling himself moving in that direction. Because the conversation is going in the wrong direction. Shaitan is whispering to you. But if you are in the dhikr of Allah, you cannot even hear shaitan. The waswasa of shaitan will be far from you. Because you are in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And ask anybody, you sit down after your salah with khushu' and with adab. With etiquette and with tranquility. And you do your tasbih. You do your 33 times subhanallah. Your 33 times alhamdulillah. 34 times Allahu Akbar. When some narrations 33 times Allahu Akbar. And you make that remembrance of Allah with tadabbur. You ponder, what am I saying? You know, sometimes we make dhikr and that dhikr requires istighfar itself. In istighfaraka hadha bihajatin ila istighfar. May Allah forgive us. That our istighfar sometimes requires istighfar. Because a person, he doesn't even say istighfar. He says istighfarullah, 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 istighfar. This is istighfar. What are you saying? What are you muttering? It's not muttering, it's dhikr. So you sit with concentration, think about what you are saying. Feel remorse for the sins that you have committed. And then you say, astaghfirullah. Astaghfirullah. Feel the naqs of your salah. Feel the deficiency of your salah. That my salah, how much was I conscious in my salah? Because that comes in hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the example of the salah is an example of a scale. Man awfa istawfa. The one who feels the scale gives it its balance. If you don't put it in the scale, if you don't put the effort, if you are not conscious in your salah, for that portion of salah for which you are not conscious that you are standing in front of Allah, you don't get reward from Allah Azza wa Jalla. There is no ajr. And for that person, you are still fulfilling a farida. You are fulfilling your obligation. But you do not get the ajr when you are ghafil. When you are in your salah, what does Allah say about salah? وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِ Salah is supposed to be established for what? For dhikr, not for ghafla. For the remembrance of Allah. You are supposed to be in your salah conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And mentions in another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that a person, he says salam. And the amount of ajr he got, the amount of reward he got for his salah was 1/10 of a full salah. 1/9 of a full salah. 1/8 of a full salah. 1/7 of a full salah, 1/6, until it mentions till 1/2 of his salah. Depending on how much within his salah he was conscious. And a good dalil, a good sign of whether or not you are conscious, whether you are in a state of dhikr, whether you are remembering Allah in your salah, is are you aware when you even are when you leave your state of dhikr? Many times we are so heedless and so detached from Allah in our salah that when we are making salah, we don't know when we were conscious and when we weren't conscious. We had no idea. It began, I made 4 rak'ah, I hardly remember the surahs I recited, I gave salam, and I know I fulfilled my farida. Yes, inshallah, you fulfilled the farida. You will not be punished. But ajr is something else. If we are taking the time, if we are taking the time to worship Allah, you are taking the time to make wudu, you are taking the time to make salah, don't we want to make sure at least we get some ajr for it? It would be nice. We should get ajr for it if we are doing it. So this is why it's so important that we should also pay attention to the sunan, to the sunnah. What is the benefit? In terms from the aspect, of course, the benefit of the sunnah is that it is a sunnah. That's all you need to know about the sunnah. In terms of why should I do it? It's because it is sunnah. That's why you should do it. But what is a side benefit of that? A side benefit of the sunnah and rawatib, of making the sunnah salah with your salah, is that it helps prepare your mind to concentrate in the fard. It helps prepare your mind to concentrate. That before dhuhr, you make 2 rak'ah or 4 rak'ah depending on the narration, you're coming from your job and your work and your mind is moving. Your mind is turning. Just like if you had a ceiling fan and you cut off the electricity for that ceiling fan. So you left work. But what happened? The fan is still moving even after you cut off the electricity. In the same way, you left work, but work is still in your head. The work didn't leave your head. The family didn't leave your head. Your obligations didn't leave your head. So what are you doing in the sunnah? In the sunnah, you are allowing the fan to come to a stop. You're making that sunnah before the fard. Prophet ﷺ also mentioned, بَيْنَ كُلَّ آذَيَنَيْنِ صَلَاةٍ That before every fard salah, it is permissible for you to, between the adhan and the iqama, that 2 rak'ah is sunnah. In some cases, it is غير مؤكد, that it is a lower level of sunnah, and in other cases, it is a higher, more emphasized importance of sunnah, depending on the salah that we are discussing. But in all cases, there is a sunnah that you can make before the fard. And that's so the purpose, that the benefit, in terms from the perspective of khushu', is that it allows your mind to slow down. Take it easy, relax. Take your mind off of this world. And so that when the time comes for your fard, you've taken it, you've calmed yourself down. And as much as possible, to aid yourself in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should have first be conscious of your intention, because intention is fard in salah. You must have an intention of which salah you are making, right? And you, of course, which salah you are making, and whether that it is faridah, for example, or that it is sunnah. You must have that intention in your heart. So with the intention, you should also have ihtisab, the desire, the yaqeen, the certainty, the hope in Allah, that Allah will give you a reward for that salah. And you should have knowledge of the virtues of salah. Because anything done without understanding the benefit and without understanding the fada'il, the desire for it is weak. But when you do something and you know what Allah will give you, why does Allah tell us what He is going to give us for what we do? Why? He is telling us because Allah created us. هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِكُمْ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِكُمْ إِذْ أَنْشَأَكُمْ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ وَإِذْ أَنْتُمْ أَجِنَّةٌ فِي بُطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ. Allah says, Allah knows more about you as He created you from the earth and He fashioned you in the wombs of your mothers. When you are still unformed flesh, Allah knew you. So Allah knows our desire and our greed and our ambition. Allah created it and instilled that in us. If we use it for khair, for desire, for what Allah is promising, then it is positive. And if we use it for the valueless dust and dirt of this world, then it becomes blameworthy. It brings out the worst in a person, and it brings evil in that person. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save all of us. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. استغفر الله يا رب. إن الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. أما بعد، الحمد لله. We like to conclude with a very famous hadith Qudsi that elucidates much and explains much about the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the importance of being conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That it says in the hadith narrated by Abu Huraira that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Allah says, أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنِّي عَبْدِي بِي. Allah is for His slave according to what His slave expects from Him. Allah inspires you about your condition with Allah. You feel it when the engine, the check engine light is on in your heart. Something's wrong. You feel it when something is going right. You know, you have a feeling that salah was accepted inshallah by Allah. And you have a feeling that salah was not accepted by Allah. That salah was not a good salah. You know when something was good, you did. And you know, even though it may have not been clear as halal or haram, but you felt the doubt in your heart. You felt it wasn't working. You felt something was wrong with it. أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنِّي عَبْدِي بِي. Allah is for His slave according to what His slave expects from Him. وَأَنَا مَعَهُ إِذَا ذَكَرَنِي. And Allah is with you. You have the ma'iyyah of Allah, the help of Allah, the support of Allah, the protection of Allah, if you are in the remembrance of Allah, if you are conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِن ذَكَرَنِي فِي نَفْسِهِ ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي نَفْسِي. That if a person engages his heart in the remembrance of Allah without engaging his tongue in the remembrance of Allah, then Allah is remembering him similarly. وَإِن ذَكَرَنِي فِي مَلَئٍ ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي مَلَئٍ خَيْرٍ مِّنْهُمْ. That if a person is to speak of Allah, to mention Allah in a gathering, that Allah will mention the name of that slave in a gathering better than his gathering. And what gathering is that? It's the gathering of Malaika. That Abdullah is mentioning, saying, remember Allah, fear Allah, obey Allah, be with Allah. He is saying that on this earth, to people who may wish to hear it, and to people who may not wish to hear it. And Allah is mentioning the name of Abdullah, his servant, in the gathering of Malaik. Allah is mentioning that servant by his name. By his name. وَإِن تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ شِبْرًا تَقَرَّبْتُ إِلَيْهِ ذِرَاعًا. That if my slave comes to me one hand span, that Allah will come to him one forearm's length. What does this explain to you? That a person's relationship with Allah and your connection with Allah is darajat. It's many levels. It's a gradient. There is someone barely conscious of Allah and someone who is a wali of Allah, who is a friend of Allah. And between them are many levels. فَإِنْ ذَكَرَنِي فِي نَفْسِي. And then it says, وَإِنْ تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ ذِرَاعًا تَقَرَّبْتُ إِلَيْهِ بَاعًا. And that if the slave comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala four arms length, Allah will come to him two arms outstretched. وَإِنْ أَتَانِي يَمْشِي أَتَيْتُهُ هَرْوَلًا. That if a person, if a slave comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala walking, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come to him running. What is this express? Not only is the relationship a gradient, but Allah, whatever effort you make in coming close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the benefit that you reap will not be one-to-one. Not for one step that you are taking, one unit of effort that you are taking to come close to Allah, that Allah will give you accordingly. No. Because Allah is Kareem. Allah is generous. That you give, Allah gives more. Allah gives more. So much so that you feel what I'm feeling doesn't match with the work that I did. I don't deserve this. And with this world, whatever effort you make to acquire the material possessions of this world, no matter how much you acquire, the more work you do to acquire it, the less satisfaction you will feel in what you acquire. So a person in their poverty acquires a paltry amount of wealth and they feel very happy. And a person in their wealth acquires a multitude of wealth, a mass amount of wealth, and they feel hardly anything. I had a billion, I get another 500 million, okay. Some period. And the homeless man gets $1, and how does he feel? So this world will only let you down. But with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever effort you make to come to Allah, you will only feel fulfillment. You will feel lack of worthiness. And not only that, but the condition for coming close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that the slave must first show his desire to come to Allah and make an effort first to come to Allah, and then Allah will come to you. Because we are Allah's slave and He is our Creator. He is in a position high and mighty, and we are in a position we are low and unworthy, and yet He is so generous, and yet He is so giving. So that's why it doesn't work. When a person says, if Allah gives me hidayah, if Allah guides me, I will do and I will do. No, that's not how it works. It's not that if Allah gives you hidayah, that you will do and you will do. No, if you do, Allah will give you hidayah. You first take the step. أنت عليك الخطوة الأولى. ليس على الله. And then Allah will give you. Even if that first step is a tear in your eye and a feeling of regret in your heart for what you may have done in the past. That may be your first shibr. That may be your first hand space to come close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then you will see with that first tear of regret, Allah will give you tawfiq to make two rak'ah, to ask Allah for forgiveness. And then after that two rak'ah of forgiveness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you tawfiq to let you come to the masjid. And then maybe after you come to the masjid, Allah will give you tawfiq to live those haram things, those haram actions that you may have been doing. It's like this, it's a cycle with Allah. Instead of a cycle of viciousness, it's a cycle of virtue. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all tawfiq to practice and convey. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافينا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت، وبارك لنا فيما أعطيت، وقنا شر ما قضيت، فإنك سبحانك تقضي ولا يقضى عليك، إنه لا يذل من واليت ولا يعز من عاديت. تباركت ربنا وتعاليت، نستغفرك اللهم ونتوب إليك. اللهم يا واصل المنقطعين أوصلنا إليك، اللهم إنا نسألك عملا صالحا تقربنا إليك. اللهم استر على مصرنا يا رب العالمين، اللهم استر عليها يا أرحم الراحمين، اللهم احفظها يا رب العالمين، اللهم أنعم عليها، اللهم أعنها يا رب العالمين. لا إله إلا أنت، سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. وصل اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.